very glad distinguished guests and speakers are with us today on this international seminar on energy and shipping jointly organized by ENA and the Master's Program in Energy of the University of Piraeus. I'm very happy I'm coordinating this session with distinguished guests and friends from the academia and from the legal practice and business. George Panagopoulos, Antonios Tsavdaridis, and Christina Hioureas, all of them with strong academic and business credentials. Let me begin with George Panagopoulos, who is the office managing partner of Reed Smith Athens office. George is an experienced commercial and litigation lawyer and has worked in Australia, London and Athens, where he's based with his lovely family. He deals with a wide variety of shipping and commercial matters, including arbitration, commercial litigation, cargo claims, charter parties insurance, ship sale and purchase, sale of goods, trade and energy. He is an international practice and deals with both English and Greek law cases. George completed a doctorate at the University of Oxford in 1999, where we met, in the field of private international law. And he has been a mentor of mine, if I may say, and a very good friend since then. He is admitted as a barrister and solicitor in Australia, solicitor of England, Wales, and an attorney in Greece, admitted to the Supreme Court of Greece. George is going to speak about litigation with particular emphasis on litigation proceedings under English law, I suppose, to litigate or to arbitrate, and also to arbitrate or to mediate. That's the question, George. The pleasure.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you for that warm introduction, Nicholas. It's very good to be here, and thank you to ENA and the University of Piraeus for organizing today. I'll be talking about litigation and arbitration, to litigate or to arbitrate, the advantages and disadvantages of those, briefly, with a particular emphasis on shipping and energy-related disputes. I'll be looking at it particularly from an English law point of view and from the point of view of London arbitration. Now, in essence, there are three options that a party may have in any transaction or any dispute. The first is, of course, litigation before the courts, arbitration, and mediation. Now, the third, mediation, is not a mutually exclusive category. It can arise from either of the two. But in very broad terms, they're the three options one can consider. By mediation, I also include alternative dispute resolution mechanisms involved with either. Now, of course, one may say, disputes in a commercial context are not ideal. It'd be better if we don't have disputes. But the fact is, disputes do arise. So the parties in any transaction, any commercial situation, have to consider whether their dispute will be resolved by one mechanism or another. Or when they're about to enter a contract or an agreement, they have to consider what avenue they're going to follow. Now, just to start with some interesting statistics that we've managed to uncover. In 2015, the Commercial Court in London, and most shipping and energy-related type disputes would go before the Commercial Court. So the Commercial Court would be that division. We're not talking about the Family Division or the Probate or some other division, the pure Commercial Court of London. 674 proceedings were commenced in 2015. That is agoyes, as we'd say in Greek, 674. There were 69 trials, hearings of cases in the Commercial Court in London in 2015, and 930 applications were heard. And that's an interesting statistic because it tells us that probably about 10%, or just a bit over 10% of all proceedings commenced in the Commercial Court in London settle. 90% of them don't make it all the way. That's an interesting fact. And one of the things we'll look at is some of the reasons why the procedure is such before the English High Court that most cases will in fact settle. And that is something It'd be interesting to do a comparison with the Greek courts and see how many cases that are commenced before the Greek courts actually end up to a full-blown hearing. I think it'd be more like 90% in the case of the Greek courts. By comparison, the arbitration figures, and we're looking at the London Maritime Arbitrators Association as a body, which most maritime shipping matters would go before, there were 3,001 appointments in 2015. So that was 3,000 arbitrations were commenced in 2015 following the LMAA procedure, and 129 following the small claims procedure, which is a more specific streamlined procedure that we'll look at. And there were 438 awards published in 2015. So that means by looking at a comparison there, about 15% roughly of all arbitrations commenced end up in a hearing, in an award. So something like 70-75% probably settle. Of those 438 awards, only 93 involved oral hearings where there was an actual proper hearing as we understand it. The others were all on documents alone. So about 350 odd were paper hearings. That is, the award was published without an actual oral hearing. And interestingly, the LMAA publishes that there were 221 mediations following the LMAA procedure. Of those, 179 were successful. That means, by successful, that means that they settled following that mediation, which is a very high proportion. Now, they are just the figures of the LMAA. There are in London, obviously, the LCIA arbitration and the ICC arbitration, which takes place, but that is an indicative, especially on the maritime and the shipping side, of the sort of cases that go to arbitration. Now, looking at the comparing court and arbitration, why might we go to court, and when can we go to court? A party in any commercial or maritime type dispute can go before the English courts as long as the English courts have jurisdiction. When will the English courts have jurisdiction? Well, the most obvious way is where there's a specific court choice of court clause. That is, that the contract has a clause in it that says that the English courts will have jurisdiction. But it is possible to go before the English courts in other circumstances. So where there is no such provision, and for example, the contract or the underlying relationship is governed by English law, it is possible to go before the English courts as long as there's no contrary jurisdiction clause. So you don't have a clause that says, that provides for arbitration, or that the courts of another country will have jurisdiction. Then the English civil procedure rules and the common law rules have various tests to determine when the English court will have jurisdiction, even in circumstances where the contract may be governed by another law or there is no jurisdiction clause. So one example is where the contract was, for example, made within England. England is the place of performance or the characteristic performance of the contract or part of it. Or there's a breach and the alleged breach has occurred within England. Or in cases where the claim is in connection with a tort, where the tort was committed within England, that is, where the elements or the most significant elements constituting the tort took place within England, or England, or they have the closest and most real connection with England. So in those circumstances, the court will have jurisdiction and one can proceed before the court. Why might we go to the court rather than arbitration? There are good arguments for going following the court procedure. And one is certainty. The English courts have a history of centuries and a very wealthy body of case law that has been applied, particularly in commercial and shipping matters, that is viewed as providing certainty in commercial transaction. There's predictability, there's a wealthy body of case law that is followed. It is not considered that the courts of England are in any way eccentric or unpredictable when parties go before them. The judges before the commercial court are usually very experienced and quite eminent. Unlike in many European jurisdictions, a judge is not someone who's just come out of law school, gone to a course for 2 years and ends up becoming a judge on the commercial court at 28. Usually the judges of the commercial court are very experienced practitioners. They've had a career behind them. They've either been successful Queen's Counsel or practitioners. Many solicitors now have been appointed to the courts of England, and one famous example is Lord Justice Lawrence Collins, who's the editor of Dicey & Morrison, both a practitioner, a former partner of Herbert Smith. Also, academics are increasingly being appointed to the commercial court, and one is Professor Beetson, who's now on the Court of Appeal. So the judges before the commercial court, because of their experience, have usually dealt with the sort of problems that are coming before them. Nothing is too surprising for them. It is said that the English courts have a history of a lack of bias and a very international focus. There's a the English pride themselves of having impartiality in their judicial system, and it's very common to have parties from various countries in proceedings before the commercial court. So it's very common to have, for example, a claimant from Russia and a defendant from China fighting out a dispute before the commercial court of London. The civil procedure rules has a very specific procedure, a very strict procedure that the parties must follow, and there are strict consequences for not following the procedural rules of the court. And there are procedural sanctions for delays. The court has the power to issue, for example, an unless order, and there are incentives for moving the case forward. And one of the other important factors is that there are incentives for the parties to settle their dispute when before the commercial court in London. One of those examples is that a losing party will pay costs if they lose in the claim, and there are incentives to settle, and in particular the what are called the Part 36 offers, which is a provision under the civil procedure rules, which in essence a Part 36 offer says that where one of the parties makes a settlement offer to the other party in the context of the proceedings, if the other party does not do better than that settlement offer, they will be penalized by way of costs for not having accepted that offer. If they go ahead and proceed with the proceedings, the judgment comes out, but they could have done much better if they'd accepted the settlement offer. The court will not have sympathy with them, and there'll be cost consequences as a result. But there are disadvantages with going to court. And one of the arguments against going to court is that it's expensive, the costs involved, and it is of course an expensive process. So the court system is probably more suitable where the claim is a large claim, a significant claim. Another disadvantage, especially for people outside of England, is that it has to take place in London. So the hearing has to take place in London, the witnesses, the experts, everyone has to be there for the hearing. Thanks to technological advances, it's possible now to run the case from Athens right up until the hearing. One can file electronically the various pleadings, deal with the procedure from outside of London, but the actual hearing has to take place there. There's a time factor as well. It's very rare that a case will be heard before 2 to 3 years after the claim form is issued. Especially if it's a significant matter. The court will have to rely on expert evidence. The court, the judges, of course, are not necessarily technical, and this is something we'll see in contrast to arbitration. And whether this is an advantage or a disadvantage, the hearing is public. So any case before the London High Court, the media is allowed to go in there, they're allowed to report on it. Any documents filed with the court are easily accessible by members of the public. It's a public and transparent process, unless it's an exceptional case where the judge in his or her discretion has deemed that it's appropriate that the matter be heard in camera. Now, arbitration, one of the fundamental things to always understand is that it will only be available if the parties agree to arbitrate. You cannot force someone to arbitrate. If they haven't agreed to go to arbitration, there's nothing to compel them to go there. And the way to agree arbitration is either through an arbitration agreement in the contract. So if you've put an arbitration clause in your contract, then you are bound to follow the arbitration procedure. or it is possible for the parties, after the dispute has arisen, to agree to proceed with arbitration. So even though the parties may have selected a choice of court clause in their contract, or they may have had nothing, they can then decide ex post facto that they'd like to go to arbitration and follow a particular type of arbitration. And finally, I think it's important to note that the procedure is available, the London arbitration procedure is available even where the dispute is in theory governed by another legal system, and it may not have any connection with London or with England. And in fact, it is possible to hold a hearing anywhere in the world. As long as the parties agree, you can have an arbitration following the London arbitration procedure here in Athens. There's no rule that it has to take place in London. Some of the advantages of arbitration is, the first is that, well, the hearing is private. And one of the reasons why a lot of commercial parties select arbitration is because it will be a private hearing. The parties are under a duty of confidentiality not to disclose the contents or the matters in the arbitration to third parties, except where necessary for the purposes of the arbitration. One of the beauties of arbitration is that the parties they select their arbitrators, and usually what happens is the claimant will select an arbitrator, the defendant will, the respondent will select an arbitrator, and the two arbitrators will select a third arbitrator or an umpire. That's the usual route followed. So you select the arbitrator, and the arbitrator may be a person with great technical expertise. So if your dispute involves, for example, a damaged engine to a ship, the arbitrator may be a marine engineer, because it's felt that that dispute requires someone with technical knowledge to understand the details of the dispute. There's great procedural flexibility in arbitration. So although there are rules of procedure to be followed, it's perfectly open for the parties to agree to vary that or to make their own rules as to how the arbitration should proceed. For example, the parties may agree that there will be no disclosure, or there will be limited disclosure, or that the matter should be heard on documents alone, or how long the hearing should be. As long as the parties can agree these matters, then there is great procedural flexibility. You can avoid an oral hearing, and you can have the hearing anywhere you like. Costs. We'll look at that in the context of disadvantages. Some of the disadvantages of arbitration is that, in our experience, the delays are more likely. Tribunals are more loath than the courts to push things along. It's far more easier for a party that doesn't wish to cooperate and move things forward to delay matters. The tribunals are more reluctant to make procedural sanctions, to make orders where a party is not performing or abiding by a particular timetable. It is often said that arbitration is cheaper than the court system, and in theory that should be the case, but in our experience, a matter before a tribunal, before arbitration, can be just as expensive as a well-run court case. So I'm not so convinced that that is always the case. You have to actually pay the tribunal, you have to pay your arbitrators if you go to arbitration, whereas hopefully you never have to pay the judge in any court case. And decisions can sometimes, with arbitration tribunals, be surprising. I say that in inverted commas. Often you do have tribunals that involve people of a non-legal background, of a technical background, and they may make a decision that might be surprising to some lawyers. And ever since the 1996 Arbitration Act, it is very difficult now, certainly under the English rules, to appeal an arbitration decision. You cannot appeal an arbitration decision on a finding of fact. You cannot appeal it just because you don't like it. You can really only appeal an arbitration decision under English law now if the tribunal got a point of law wrong. There's a clear error of law, and you can appeal on that. You can only otherwise appeal if there's been a miscarriage of justice or there's been a denial of natural justice in the hearing in the arbitration matter. So the ability to appeal, and that's a positive and a negative, is not so great. Now moving on and looking at some examples of the sort of arbitration and court clauses, an example of a choice of court clause is, for example, clause 49 of the BP Voyage Charter Form. Very simply, it says the High Court in London shall have exclusive jurisdiction over any dispute which may arise out of or in connection with this charter. So that's pretty straightforward. An example of an arbitration clause, this is the standard LMAA clause, and one which, if I may say, I think is a very well-drafted one. Often we do in contracts see very badly drafted clauses where it's not clear what the parties actually intended. This is, I think, a good example. What it provides is that the contract will be governed by English law, and any dispute arising out of or in connection with this contract shall be referred to arbitration in London in accordance with the Arbitration Act. And then it follows a procedure of how the arbitration will be run, that a party wishing to refer a dispute to arbitration shall appoint its arbitrator and then give the other side notice and 14 days to appoint their arbitrator. And if they don't appoint their arbitrator within 14 days, then the first party, the party that first appointed an arbitrator, has the right to make their arbitrator the sole arbitrator. And that is a pretty standard and solid arbitration clause in there. The problem sometimes is where you have a clause that merely says all disputes will be referred to arbitration in London. It's not really clear how many arbitrators, what procedure is going to be followed, and that's something that the parties need to either agree to or they need to look to the Arbitration Act for that, and that creates a lot of ambiguity. So it's very important whenever putting in an arbitration clause in a contract to make sure it's as clear as possible. There is the possibility of what's called a hybrid arbitration clause. This is something we discovered in a particular case. It's not something I would necessarily recommend, but we do see it. In this case, what the contract provided for is that the parties would go to arbitration, but notwithstanding the arbitration clause, the parties would have the right to go to court within 14 days of the first party nominating an arbitrator. So you had the option of selecting court if you wanted to. It is a clause that could give rise to ambiguities, but it does. There are possibilities of having a combination of arbitration and court litigation in a clause. Something we also see, which is quite common, is to have a clause which says that disputes under $100,000 will be referred to arbitration, and any disputes over a certain sum, say $100,000, will be referred to court. Another very important consideration about whether we go to whether we commence court proceedings, and this may be a telling factor, or arbitration, are the startup costs. As of 2015, quite surprisingly, the English court system has introduced fees which are much larger than they used to be for commencing proceedings. And interestingly, a claim between £10,000 and £200,000, there's a fee of 5% of the claim. So it would be, if it was a £200,000 claim, that would be £10,000. That's quite a significant investment. Claims over £200,000, there is a court fee of £10,000. This is significantly more than what it was about 2-3 years ago, where the cost was about £800 to £1,200 to institute a very significant claim. And as a result of this, there's been a reduction in the number of claims issued before the London High Court. In fact, we looked at the figure earlier of 2015, which had 640, if I remember correctly, claims issued in 2015. In approximately 2012 and 13, there were approximately 1,500 claims issued, so they've been reduced significantly. On the other hand, arbitration does not cost that much to institute. Following the LMAA procedure, you have an arbitrator's appointment fee of £250, and then thereafter, the arbitrator's hourly rate for whatever work they do, and usually a ballpark average for most London arbitrators would be about £300 an hour. I'd be reluctant to pay more than that. So instituting arbitration proceedings is actually not that expensive. It's what goes on afterwards that can be more costly. Another thing worthy of note is the LMAA small claims procedure. Now, this is a procedure designed for particularly smaller claims. It's a streamlined procedure. What the procedure provides is that the parties will only issue and serve a claim, a defence and a reply, no further submissions. There's no general disclosure. Any documents the parties wish to rely on, they exhibit to their claim or their defence. There is no hearing, it's all on documents. And the costs are capped. So the small claims fee for the claimant is £3,000 and an administration fee of £250. And there's a cap on the costs recoverable, so the successful party may recover a maximum of £4,000, £4,500 where there is a counterclaim. So this is an attractive option, particularly for smaller claims. You've got to get it right from the start, from the claim, but it's a streamlined procedure. And we find in a lot of charter parties in particular that they provide for the small claims procedure for claims under a certain value, usually under $100,000 or $50,000. And this is an example of a small claims procedure clause. It's actually in the BIMCO new build con, and it provides for a small claims procedure for claims under $100,000. Now, finally, one other important area, and this is something particular to the English and the common law legal system, and that's security for costs. And no analysis or no discussion about the court and arbitration procedure in under the English rules is complete without discussing this. What is security for costs? Well, security for costs is where a claimant brings a claim against the defendant is entitled to security in respect of its costs of defending the claim in circumstance where there is concern or doubt whether the claimant will ultimately be able to pay a costs order that is made against that claimant if they lose. So, typically, where you have a Marshall Islands claimant bringing proceedings against another party, and that entity owns one ship or may own nothing, that is a good argument for security for costs, because that is a company, an offshore company with no assets. It's brought a claim before the court or in arbitration, and at the end of the day, if it loses, there's no security, no guarantee that it'll be able to pay the defendant's costs. It is also possible for a claimant to seek security for costs where a defendant has brought a counterclaim. And the security will often be in the form of a bank guarantee or a P&I club letter of undertaking. Now, the basic rules, and just looking at the difference between court and arbitration in this regard, under the civil procedure rules, under Rule 25, Subrule 13, a defendant is entitled to security for costs either because the claimant is essentially foreign, is either not resident within the jurisdiction, i.e. is not English, or is not from a Brussels contracting state or a Lugano contracting state, that is not from a European Union or European Free Trade Association state, or where the claimant is a company or body and there is reason to believe that it will be unable to pay the defendant's costs if ordered to do so. There's concern about its financial position. Or, as we see in D, E, F, and G, where the claimant has undertaken activities that are suspicious as to its whole conduct. They are mala fide acts, for example, changing its address for the purpose of evading litigation, has given a wrong address in the claim form, is actually acting as a nominal claimant, there's someone else behind that claimant, or where the claimant has been moving assets about at the time so that it would be difficult to enforce a costs order against the claimant. The amount of security is ultimately at the discretion of the court, but will include an estimate of the costs that will be incurred. The court may also factor in the costs of executing such an order overseas. In court proceedings, you can make a security for costs application at any time once proceedings have been served. And the court may actually order the security to be paid into court, or alternatively, a bank guarantee from a suitable bank, and in maritime matters, a P&I club letter of undertaking is usually considered good security. Contrast this with arbitration, where if following the LMAA procedure, you can only seek security for costs after pleadings have been completed. You can't do it from the outset. And under Section 38, Subsection 3 of the Arbitration Act, you cannot rely on the fact that the claimant is foreign, is from another jurisdiction. You have to rely on the financial position of the claimant to get security for costs in arbitration proceedings. So the classical example would be, for example, in an MOA, sale and purchase dispute, where the claimant has sold the ship, the claimant is a Panamanian company, for example, with no assets, it is almost invariable that that claimant will have to provide security for costs, will have to put their money where their mouth is if they brought this claim and be able to guarantee the costs of the other side going forward if they want to proceed with the case. The consequences for not complying with the security for costs order are quite draconian. In court proceedings, the claim may be struck out and judgment may be entered for the defendant, with the costs of the claim to be subject to an assessment. And under Section 41(6) of the Arbitration Act, if the claimant fails to comply with a peremptory order by the tribunal for security for costs, then the tribunal may make an award dismissing the claimant's claim. So it's game over. Very draconian consequences, very important to be able to guarantee the other side's costs unless you are a company with assets. So in conclusion, whether looking at court and arbitration, they are ultimately very comparable processes. They're of great similarities. Both involve significant investment of time and costs. The main advantage of arbitration is the flexibility. Procedurally, there's great flexibility in any arbitration, and the fact that the dispute is ultimately private. I would say that is the main advantage. Whereas at the end of the day, court proceedings, notwithstanding some of the technical difficulties, at the end of the day, the consequence of a court judgment still carries a lot of weight, and that is its ultimate advantage. Thank you very much. That concludes my presentation.
Thank you very much, George, for this excellent presentation of the cons and pros and the advantages and disadvantages in shipping and energy disputes to litigate or to arbitrate. And this was an excellent introduction as well to arbitration and litigation proceedings. As far as the Greek situation is also concerned, what's going on in Athens, what's going on in Greek disputes. We're going to elaborate on this by Antonios Tsavdaridis. Antonios Tsavdaridis is a distinguished lawyer, is an academic. He's a lecturer at the Faculty of Law of the University of Thrace. He teaches international trade law and international arbitration, and at the same time, he practices law. He's the partner responsible for arbitration in 14 offices of the well-known Rokas law firm based in Athens in 13 jurisdictions. He has appeared as a counsel, co-arbitrator, chairman in a large number of international arbitration and has extensive arbitration and litigation experience with particular emphasis in international trade law. He is a board member of the European Court of Arbitration and chairman of its Greek chapter, vice chairman of the Greek Association for Arbitration, board member of the Piraeus Association for Maritime Arbitration and the Greek chapter of the International Association of Insurance Law. He has published several books and articles in legal journals on international arbitration and international trade law. Antonios, thanks very much for being here with us, and the floor is yours.
So kind words. I mean, I feel awkward. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being today with us. Great thanks to ENA and to the University of Piraeus for their kind invitation to this one-day seminar. I'm going to talk about arbitration issues in general, and in particular as well, to shipping and energy disputes. First of all, some questions. How many of you have a legal background? That's good. How many of you have experience in arbitration? how many of you are familiar with arbitration? Okay, so let's carry on, and I will start with a short introduction. First of all, with respect to this successful partnership between shipping and arbitration. It's good to know your clients. First of all, almost 90% of contracts contain an arbitration clause. And this is equally true not only for maritime transactions, but also for commercial transactions as well. Such arbitration clauses could be standalone arbitration clauses, that means that they contain a provision with respect to arbitration solely. Some of them are mixed arbitration clauses in the sense that they provide for a combination of various mechanisms, providing for arbitration, for alternative dispute resolution, maybe mediation or conciliation, and sometimes they provide for a certain period of time in which the management of the disputant parties have the chance to attempt to find an amicable solution and a cooling off period. Nevertheless, almost in only 10% of these contracts, we may proceed to disputes. And of these, almost 90% are settled. Therefore, it remains a very small percentage, of which, again, 90% of the disputes are referred to arbitration. So at the end of the day, from drafting an arbitration clause to end up in an arbitration, it takes a long way. Now, the shipping is an endless source of arbitration cases. And shipping disputes, of course, are related either directly or indirectly to a ship. As a result, figures in maritime arbitration follow figures in shipping. According to UNCTAD, which is the United Nations Commission on Trade and Development, there's a nice chart here, for 2015, the world commercial fleet counted for almost 90,000 ships around the world, which is a significant number. And you can imagine that out of this number of ships, maritime arbitrations are generated. And there was an increase. The world fleet grew by 3.5% compared to the previous year, 2014. And this is considered to be the lowest annual growth rate in over a decade. Out of these 90,000 vessels, there are five ship-owning countries which owe almost 50% of the total capacity. Greece is one of them. Surprise, surprise. So you can imagine that in most of the cases, you will find either a claimant or a respondent who has interests from these countries, Greece, Japan, China, Germany, or from Singapore. A few words about the advantages and disadvantages of arbitration. We've heard some things from George a while ago. there are many advantages and many disadvantages. There are huge lists that may start enumerating pros and cons. But which are the most important ones? There are three basic factors that lead people to arbitrate instead of litigate. The most important one is the international effectiveness of arbitral awards. And this means two things. It means, first of all, enhanced enforceability around the world, because when you have an award, you want to enforce it. And you don't want to enforce it in theory, but you want to enforce it somewhere where the losing party has assets so that you can get what he owes to you. This is safeguarded by a well-known international convention, the New York Convention of 1958, which is one of the most successful, probably the most successful international instrument in private law international conventions. The New York Convention has been so far ratified by a huge number of states around the world. If I'm not wrong, the number is over 160 nations all over the world. You can hardly find another international convention that has been so successful. In comparison to court litigation, you will not find an international convention which facilitates enforcement of court judgments around the world. There are only regional instruments that allow this to happen, and a prime example is regulation 1215 of 2012 of the European Union, the former regulation 44, former Brussels Convention. Apart from enforceability, though, people want to avoid certain legal systems that may create problems in trying to resolve a case. Delays, inefficient court systems, national court systems, people want to avoid. So, arbitration is a very good alternative for so doing. Choice of arbitrators is one of the unique features of arbitration, because unlike court litigation, where you cannot choose your judge, in arbitration you choose your own arbitrator. You appoint your arbitrator, the other party appoints his arbitrator, and they both appoint the third one, or the third one is appointed by an appointing authority, unless the tribunal is a sole arbitrator tribunal, in which case if the two parties cannot agree on the person of the arbitrator, then he is appointed by an appointing authority to which both of the parties have agreed beforehand, or if there is no such authority, they can ask from the local court that supervises the arbitration to do so. Flexibility is another very important factor, because it allows parties to shape arbitration procedure as they like. So arbitration, to a certain extent, is a tailor-made method for dispute resolution. Unlike court litigation, where of course you find everything there and you just need to follow the existing rules. What I described earlier is shown in a very illustrative way In the results of the 2015 International Arbitration Survey, which was conducted by the Queen Mary University of London, and in particular its International Arbitration School, and Whiten case. Here you can see, in a very illustrative way, how people consider as the most salient features of arbitration the enforceability of awards by 65% and the avoidance of specific legal systems or national courts by another 64%. So both these factors together constitute the international effectiveness that arbitral awards have. Flexibility and selection of arbitrators are also there among the prime features of international arbitration. Same goes with disadvantages of arbitration. The most notorious one is the cost. Of course, there are English courts, which are even more expensive than arbitration. But in comparison to court litigation in other national legal systems, arbitration appears to be more expensive. Personally, I disagree, because the end result, if you are able to have an arbitration award sooner than later, and this, of course, is in comparison to national systems where it takes many, many years to get a final and appealable judgment by the courts. A good example is the Greek legal system, where it may take up to 10 years to finalize the litigation up to the Supreme Court level. You may, at the end of the day, pay more money to for the fees of your arbitrators, etc. But at the end of the day, if you are the losing party, you pay less interest. Or if you are the claimant and you have won, you may have avoided a bankruptcy because you may have needed that money earlier than later on. Another disadvantage is the lack of effective sanctions in the arbitral process. This is indeed a very serious one, because as you may have known, arbitrators cannot coerce parties to do something. Arbitrators may issue an order, but parties are not compelled to execute that order. So you need to go to the national court in order to have it enforced. So we may have now the ability of arbitrators to order interim measures, for instance. We even have emergency arbitrators for urgent matters. But what they will say is not obligatory for the parties to follow, and you need the assistance of local courts to do that. So it is not unusual that in many cases, because of this disadvantage, arbitrators are forced to draw adverse inferences if a party just fails to follow what has been ordered by the arbitral tribunal. If we can again see the results of this survey, we can see again in a very illustrative way that costs are considered by a majority of nearly 70% to be the most important flaw in arbitration. Although, as I told you, this is only partly right. And the lack of effective sanctions during the arbitral process comes second with 46%. Now, maritime arbitration has an inherent international character. And this comes from the applicable law itself in the first place. And why is this? Because maritime law, irrespective of the fact that it is always a national law that applies, and in most cases, English law applies. It's like the lingua franca in international shipping. Irrespective of this fact, all national laws follow a dense network of international instruments, international conventions, and privately oriented regulations such as Hague-Visby rules, York Antwerp rules, because Hague-Visby rules is an international convention. There is an internationality which comes from the framework that regulates shipping. And secondly, there is a practical aspect, the mobility of ships, because ships have a propeller, and that allows them to go everywhere in the world. And they can avoid taxes, and sometimes they can avoid even arrest. Maritime arbitration enjoys a certain degree of autonomy compared to commercial arbitration. Although in practice, if you follow the conduct of a maritime arbitration, you will not be able to discern specific differences compared to commercial arbitration. Nevertheless, there are some significant differences with respect to the way maritime arbitration operates, which is based on trade practices, which are consolidated in standard form contracts, which contain standard form arbitration clauses. And maritime arbitration is different to commercial arbitration in the way it is organized. We will see that maritime arbitration is conducted by arbitration centers and on the basis of arbitration rules, which are very specialized, and they are purposely made, drafted only for maritime arbitrations. The operation part. Internationally, prevailing trade practices reveal a uniform regulatory framework which governs the requirements of arbitral choice. We have standard arbitration clauses in widespread use. The most salient manifestations of these can be found, first of all, in sea transport, in carriage of goods by sea, where we can see in charter parties multiple choice clauses that contain references to arbitration in London in most of the cases, New York in some of the cases, and there is also a third choice for the parties to fill in with the choice they like if they don't want to follow the London or the New York options. In most of the cases, I would say, London arbitration is set as the default position in these charter parties. In bills of lading, we see the phenomenon of incorporation clauses, which refer to the arbitration clause of the charter party under which the bill of lading has been issued. And there are differences in the various national laws as to whether a general reference or a specific reference is required for an effective and valid incorporation of the Charter Party arbitration clause. We can also see standard form arbitration clauses in salvage. A unique example is LOF, the Lloyd's Open Form, which is now in its 2011 edition, which is accompanied with the Lloyd's standard salvage and arbitration clauses and the procedural rules for arbitration. And in ship sale, for instance, we have the sale form 2012, or in shipbuilding, where we also have a variety of shipbuilding contracts that contain standard form arbitration clauses. Moving now to the organizational dimension of maritime arbitration, we are able to observe a dense concentration. Almost 90% of maritime arbitrations around the world are held in London, and in particular under the London Maritime Arbitrators Association terms, of which the latest version is that of 2012. And just 10% is distributed to other peripheral centers. Prime examples of them are New York, with the Society of Maritime Arbitrators. Its rules have been recently modified in 2016. And Singapore, the Singapore Chamber of Maritime Arbitration rules of 2015. 20 years ago, just 20 years ago, London had 70%. New York had 20%. And peripheral centers 10%. So we can see a shift towards London in the last 20 years. As I told you, you will not see many differences in conducting an arbitration, a maritime arbitration, compared to a commercial arbitration. You will also not be able to see any particular differences as regards the arbitration mechanism when you have shipping and energy disputes. Nevertheless, the difference is in the subject matter of the dispute. And such disputes that touch upon shipping and energy at the same time could refer to carriage of goods with crude oil, petroleum derivatives, gas, LNG, or LPG and coal, to supplies such as bunkers, to shipbuilding with respect to tankers, LNGs, LPGs, cable layers, to offshore structures, drilling vessels, crane vessels, which may be used for laying pipelines in the sea, installation vessels, floating LNG terminals and oil rigs, and also such disputes may refer to related matters to energy and shipping, such as chartering, finance and insurance. A few words for arbitration, maritime arbitration in Greece, before closing. Greece, although is one of the most important seafaring nations and ship owners, who are among the most important around the world, does not have a tradition of arbitration on its soil. Nevertheless, there are two centers for maritime arbitration in Greece. The first one, which is the younger one, is Piraeus Association for Maritime Arbitration. And its rules are the most modern compared to the other set of rules of the Shipping Chamber of Commerce. quite advanced, I would say, and internationally oriented. For arbitrations of international character, and set to be able to work, to operate together with law 2735 of 1991, which is the Greek law for international commercial arbitration, which is the adoption by Greece of UNCITRAL model law on international commercial arbitration. The other center is the Shipping Chamber of Greece. This is the oldest center. It exists since the 60s, but is only domestically oriented for disputes that involve only domestic interests. Nevertheless, quite recently, there was a law provision by law 4150/2013, which changed this, and the Shipping Chamber of Greece is now able to conduct also international maritime arbitrations. Why this has happened with the law? Because the arbitration of the Shipping Chamber of Greece is an institutional arbitration that was established by a legislative instrument, and so there was a need for an intervention by the legislator in order to change this flow. Piraeus Association for Maritime Arbitration is a private initiative by members of the industry, and its rules were not inaugurated by, were not sanctioned by a legislative instrument, and can be changed only by the change of the articles of association of the association. That concludes my presentation. Thank you so much for being today.
Thank you very much, Antoni. I remember a few years ago your passion about introducing to Greece international institutions of arbitration, setting up this maritime center in Piraeus. I hope at some point we see this center going forward with
nice had a few cases
and balanced arbitration decisions. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Christina Hioureas, and she's going to speak about risk reduction in energy shipping investment treaty-based strategies for energy shipping investors. Christina Hioureas flew from New York. Thank you very much for being here with us. And she's going back on Sunday. She's really a rising star of energy arbitration. We have been collaborated and we have been friends for some years now. I can say that we're going to see a lot of her involvement coming up soon in various instances, both in Greece and internationally. Christina Hioureas is a counsel at Foley, Hoag, the international litigation and arbitration practice. She represents states, private and state-owned entities, individuals on international disputes and public international law matters. She also advises states on matters before the United Nations and its bodies, including the United Nations Commission on International Trade Law, UNCITRAL. She has particular experience on matters including energy law and arbitration, oil and gas, and alternative energy, gas supply and price revisions and negotiations, international investment treaty claims and litigation, treaty drafting and interpretation. She has also served as an adjunct professor at Fordham University School of Law in New York. She received her Juris Doctorate from the University of California, Berkeley, and she's admitted to practice in California, New York, England, Wales, and before the U.S. Supreme Court. Christina, the floor is yours. Thank you
for staying this late in the afternoon. Mr. Farantouris said, I will be speaking about the reduction of risk through the use of investment arbitration. Now, this afternoon, our first panelists, two panelists addressed the issue of international commercial arbitration, that is the resolution of commercial disputes between companies in different countries, and the resolution of commercial disputes before domestic courts. Our second speaker addressed international commercial arbitration with an emphasis on shipping arbitration. Today I'm going to be speaking about a completely different framework for international arbitration that does not arise from a contractual relationship. Instead, it arises under what are called bilateral and multilateral investment treaties. What these treaties are treaties between two states in the case of bilateral investment treaties, or three or more states in the case of multilateral investment treaties, whereby the state parties to the treaties assure, they promise that they are not going to harm the investors of the nationality of any of the other contracting states. So I'm going to speak about what are these treaties, how can host states reduce their liability under these treaties, how can foreign investors, including those in the shipping industry, use these investment treaties to protect their investments, and then I'll go through a few samples if we have the time. So as I stated up front, investment treaties are treaties between an investor state and a host state. So take, for example, a company that is incorporated in Cyprus that is investing in Greece, a shipping company. That would be under the treaty between Greece and Cyprus for the protection of foreign investment. There are approximately 3,000 of such treaties in force, and they cover about two-thirds of foreign investment, according to the UN sources. And claims under these treaties can range from a couple million up to even a few billion these days. They create enforceable standards of treatment for states. So what that means is that an investor can bring a claim under a state under these treaties without having any privity of contract at all. And I'll explain what that means shortly when we go through the protections. The awards under these treaties are enforceable just as if they were a domestic court decision of any of the member states of the ICSID Convention, which I'll also explain a bit more about. So what these treaties state is that states like Greece, for example, or Cyprus or Germany or the UK, these countries, anyone who has signed onto these treaties, they have to abide by the terms of the treaties. That's their international obligation, meaning that they can't unlawfully expropriate an investment. They have to treat foreign investors fairly and equitably. They have to provide full protection and security, national treatment, most favored nation, transfer of payments, and umbrella clause. And I'll speak about what each of these terms means in due course. The benefit for states is that states sign these treaties because it's a way of signaling to foreign investors that it's a safe place to invest. By signing this treaty, the state signals, I'm willing to abide by these rules and I'm willing to be sued before the World Bank if I don't comply with these rules. And for investors, these treaties provide them with protection that if they are investing in a country, particularly one that may have a riskier reputation, and something goes wrong, they don't have to resort to domestic courts to resolve that dispute. They can go before the World Bank and a neutral body. So these treaties cover all aspects of energy-related activity, including trade, transit, investment efficiency, and so forth. And one of such treaties includes the Energy Charter Treaty. That's an example of a multilateral investment treaty. So, from the state perspective, for countries that have entered into these treaties, before they enter into these treaties or even thereafter, it's important to understand what liabilities result. What we found, I've advised Cyprus and South Africa and many countries in Latin America, and what we found is that many of these states in the 1990s signed on to these treaties without really understanding what they mean. They just thought it was a good idea to signal that this is a safe investment environment. But what happened in the 90s and 2000s and up to today is that there have been a flurry of cases brought by foreign investors against states under these treaties, and now states are starting to realize that we need to pay attention to that. There have been a couple claims against Greece, two claims against Greece under ICSID, and four claims against Cyprus. So Greece and Cyprus are starting to get a little bit more savvy about the treaties. But what's important for states to realize is that passing regulations or dramatically increasing taxes, for example, could open the country up to liability. Foreign investors can utilize the protection of these treaties so that they can structure their investments through a jurisdiction that allows them to have protection under these treaties. I'll give you an example. Let's say that there is a foreign investor from Dubai, and that investor wants to invest in Greece, but there is no bilateral investment treaty between Greece and the United Arab Emirates. So if that investor from Dubai invests in Greece and taxes are increased in a dramatic way, or their investment is expropriated, the government decides, we went through the whole Taipeth process and we privatized this company, but we decided that was a bad decision and now we want that investment back, and they take it back. That would be a breach of the treaty. But in the case of the investor from Dubai, if they invested directly into Greece, they would not have such protection because there's no treaty in place between Greece and UAE. So what the investor could do is structure their investment through a holding company in a country that does have a treaty with Greece. For example, that UAE entity could create a holding company in Cyprus or a holding company in the Netherlands, and from the Netherlands invest into Greece, and then it would be entitled to protection under the Cyprus-Greece Treaty or the Netherlands-Greece Treaty, then elevating the dispute to an international dispute before the World Bank instead of before Greek courts. Okay, this is just to speed this along. For potential claims, arbitration is not always the best approach, but what these treaties provide is leverage for investors to negotiate a good settlement with the state. So when we work with foreign investors, we often utilize these treaties as a way to help facilitate a discussion where the state can come to a positive agreement with the investor and thereby avoid arbitration completely. Before I get into sample cases, I want to speak a little bit more about what these protections are. So I spoke earlier about the prohibition against unlawful expropriation. What does that mean exactly? Expropriation is permissible, that is, a governmental taking. It is permissible if it complies with international law. It violates international law if the state expropriated the entity without a public purpose, if it did so on a discriminatory basis, or if it failed to comply with due process, or failed to provide fair and effective compensation without delay. A breach of any of those four standards would mean that it's an unlawful expropriation, entitling the investor to a claim before the World Bank. What's an example of that? A few years ago, before his passing, President Hugo Chavez of Venezuela had decided that foreign investors were corrupting the Venezuelan economy and they had seized too much control over the private sector. So what he did is he, on his Sunday morning show called Alo Presidente, he would sign every Sunday a regulation saying, I'm expropriating ConocoPhillips, I'm expropriating ExxonMobil. These are now state-owned entities. What he was doing was a violation of the treaty between Venezuela and the place where that foreign investor came from. And because he did so, he may have had a public purpose that may be to promote, to assist the Venezuelan economy, for example. Because he didn't provide fair compensation, that was a breach of the treaty. Or because he expressed that those companies were capitalists and he wanted to eliminate capitalists from the country, that was done on a discriminatory basis and therefore constituted a breach of the treaty. The fair and equitable treatment standard, which I mentioned, under that standard, the state undertakes not to impose arbitrary or discriminatory measures against a foreign investor. So let's say that a investor invests in a country and then the state decides that they want to increase the taxes dramatically, or they want to pass a regulation whereby this company has to now provide a percentage of their goods. So say it's an orange grower who now the government specifies that they need to sell a certain quantity of oranges in the domestic market for below the cost of producing them. That regulation would be something that would potentially violate the fair and equitable treatment standard and constitute a breach of the treaty. The full protection and security standard, which I mentioned, that standard says that governments promise that they will not allow an investment to be harmed by violence. So let's give an example here. Say there are political demonstrations. People are very angry about one political party or the other during the course of elections. And there are Molotov cocktails that are being thrown at foreign companies because the protesters don't want these foreign companies in the country. Now, if those foreign companies call the Greek National Guard or the police force, and the police force ignores their calls and says, okay, we have other priorities, or you're a foreign investor, use your own private security guards, we're not going to help you, that could constitute a breach of the treaty, and any damages suffered by those foreign companies, they could bring a claim against Greece before the World Bank for failing to protect their foreign investment. So these are just a few examples of the types of protections afforded by these treaties. And the scary thing is that, as I mentioned, a lot of states don't really understand that they have these obligations because they sign these treaties because they were told to, and they thought it would encourage foreign investment without really understanding the implications. So in my practice, I work both with states to try to reduce their liability, to understand what these treaties are, to make sure that their laws are compliant with the treaties, and with foreign investors to help them make sure that their foreign investments are protected and they've structured their investment through a jurisdiction that has a treaty to give them that type of protection. So in the energy field, this is something that is particularly relevant for shipping industry and for those transiting energy, because something like a dramatic increase in the tariffs for the transiting of energy could constitute a breach of the Energy Charter Treaty or of a bilateral treaty itself. I have a few case samples, but in the interest of time, I gave you a couple of samples. So just to sum it up, when making an investment in a foreign jurisdiction for shipping companies and for energy companies, it's important to think about the implications of these treaties. It's important to look to, does a treaty exist between where you are incorporated and where you want to invest? If such a treaty doesn't exist, then that foreign investor might consider structuring their investment through a holding company that does have a treaty between the state. And if the host state starts to interfere with your investment, seek advice as to how you could structure your negotiations in an attempt to have that regulation reversed or have the expropriation reversed by raising the fact that the treaty exists. It might be a way for investors to avoid arbitration and avoid litigation altogether with just by raising the fact that they're protected under these treaties and that the state may not have been aware of this. This is the sample cases show that this is an increasing area that is affecting energy transiting and shipment and energy production. So it's something to keep your eyes out, keep your lookout for. And for investors, it's important to think about your legal protections up front before making an investment and as the investment progresses. And for countries, for states like Greece, like Cyprus, it's important to think about their liability under these treaties and trying to avoid liability through making sure that laws are compliant with treaty obligations. So with that, I conclude, and I look forward to any questions you may have. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Christina. Thanks. Some of us, we had the chance, the privilege to be welcomed by Christina Hioureas a few months ago in New York in her offices in Manhattan and discuss issues relating to international litigation, arbitration, and in particular, investment treating, enforcement, and procedures. Thanks very much. We now have the whole picture of international arbitration or litigation regarding shipping and energy. And in the interest of time, I may welcome one or two, a couple of questions from the audience, and then proceed to our next session. Yeah, please.
I would like to ask you, Mrs. Hioureas, about creepy expropriation, which is very, very difficult to be proven, and it's very debatable, if you have a small comment. Thank you.
Excuse me, can we have your name and capacity?
My name is Rokas. I'm a lawyer here in Greece. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. That's a really excellent question. So the question is about what is called creeping expropriation. So the form of expropriation that I mentioned in my example of Hugo Chavez, I was talking about a direct expropriation. That's an expropriation where a government says, I'm going to take this company, and they directly indicate that. A creeping expropriation is a form of an indirect expropriation. Indirect expropriation is where a state passes a measure that has the effect of reducing the value of a company. So the state isn't saying, I'm going to seize your company, but they pass a regulation that is so harmful, it's as if you just took away a significant portion of the business. An example of that is the orange grower who is obligated to sell a certain percentage of his or her goods to the domestic market at below the cost of production. That's not a complete taking of the company, but it's reduced the value of the company to such an extent that it essentially constitutes a taking. Now, the creeping expropriation is a form of this indirect expropriation, and what that is that a state may pass a series of harmful measures, and each one of those measures in and of itself is not an expropriation. It's just slightly increasing the taxes, then imposing a regulation that slightly reduces the value, imposes certain obligations on the state that in and of themselves are not exactly a treaty breach. But when you look at the collective effect of each of those small acts over the course of time, collectively they've reduced the value of the company so as to constitute, they've creeped slowly into an expropriation. It is a controversial area of law because the question is, well, how do you know how many of those small steps are sufficient to constitute a full taking? So there's various cases that have come down differently. And the other issue is, well, how do you value the investment? If it is an expropriation, when do you calculate damages? Do you calculate damages at the first instance of creeping, of the creep, the first bad act? Or do you value it at the point of no return, where there was a substantial taking, or when there was an ultimate taking? All of these issues are being debated and being resolved in different arbitral decisions, but as we know, there's no opinio juris in these investment arbitration tribunals, so the one tribunal may come down one way and another one quite differently.
Thanks. Thank you very much. Any more questions, or we stop for a... Oh, one more. Yes, please.
I was wondering about the treaties that you mentioned. Is there any chance for a state to terminate one of those treaties? I'm assuming that if it's a bilateral treaty, there might be a chance if there is a clause talking about termination or duration of the treaty, but I'm assuming that if it's just an international treaty, it won't be that easy. And I was wondering, is it connected with the World Bank membership, or can the states proceed with amendments and new treaties on those issues?
Presumably this is for Ms. Hioureas as well?
Yes, yes, I'm sorry.
That's another really excellent question. So under the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties, state parties to a treaty can mutually terminate it under Article 38. So there are two parties to a treaty, they decide they don't want to have that treaty anymore, they can terminate it. But let's say there's a situation where only one party to the treaty wants to terminate. Let's say it's the Greece-Cyprus Treaty, and Greece decides they want to terminate that. Each treaty has a termination clause, and it specifies for unilateral termination, the state can, most common clauses say after a period, the treaty will remain in force for 10 years. After 10 years, either state may send a notification to the other of termination, and that notification will be effective after 6 months. Only after 6 months is the termination effective. However, most of these treaties also contain what's called a sunset clause, meaning that investments that have been made prior to the date of termination still get protection under the treaty for a period of 10 or 15 or 20 years. So unilateral termination actually doesn't really get states out of liability under these treaties. What you need is joint termination, getting the other country on board in order to terminate liability under the treaties. So in the examples I gave you of the 1990s treaties that are so heavily in favor of foreign investors, whereas the treaties today are more balanced, and that's what exercises like Cyprus and South Africa and Latin American states are making an effort to create treaties that allow a state to regulate, that allow that without being overly oppressive as the 1990s BITs. Those states are having discussions with their counterparty states to look to jointly terminate the treaties, because unilateral termination has that sunset clause that still allows claims for a period to drag on.
Thank you very much, Christina. Thank you all. Bear with us. Let's have a break for 5-10 minutes. And no break. Immediately change. Okay. Right. Thank you.
So we will skip the fuel pricing crystal ball, looking into a crystal ball and forecasting, and we will basically focus a bit more on the drivers which have to do with environmental regulations. You see many boxes in this timeline, and many boxes is never good. Many boxes actually mean many regulations, and here you have some indicative regulations around in the environment. We talked earlier about CO2, the MRV, the NOx emissions, SOx emissions, you have the EEDI, but basically one of the most important ones coming also in, have already implemented and coming also more regulations in the near future, is regulations that have to do with emissions in sulfur. And basically you have the SECAs and ECAs, as we discussed earlier, and we will see here. You had the SECAs, which is the environmental control areas regarding sulfur, which were implemented in 2015 in North US and North Sea and the Baltics. You have EU, which from 2020 has already decided that we'll implement, and this has to do with EU waters and the waters covering the European Economic Zone. You have China recently announced that they will impose also sulfur regulations of around 0.5 limit in some of their coastal areas, namely ports around the Shanghai areas and Beijing. You know, we already all of us see in the news the terrible environment and local pollution in China, and this is an effort towards reducing these risks and problems. And finally, we have IMO, which is talking about the global sulfur cap. It's either 2020 or 2025, still to be decided. Around 2018, IMO will gather and see what is the progress and if oil majors are ready to supply fuel which has in enough quantity, because already fuel, MGO, we know, has a sulfur content less than 0.5 and can provide to the industry and to the shipping industry to use and burn. But still the debate is regarding quantities. And 2018, they will decide if this will be, the global sulfur cap will be implemented in 2020 or 2025. This means that wherever you sail in the world, you'll need to use fuel with a sulfur content of 0.5. And currently we have fuels, heavy fuel oil is around 3.5, 2.7, depending on where you will bunker. As we saw also earlier, one of the options to reduce sulfur is alternative fuels, and one of the alternative fuels is LNG, and one of the most reliable options at the moment, or popular options. We also saw scrubbers and also the low sulfur fuels as MGO and MDO, but in this case we will look a bit into LNG, and especially the LNG fueled fleet development. Since 2000, or in 2000, we had the first LNG-fueled vessel. It was a retrofit of a ferry. It took place in Norway. And for 13 years, LNG-fueled vessels were only in Norway. So now the development trend is moving from local, and by local we mean Norway, to global. From 2013, we saw orders coming from other places outside Norway, and we will see the trends later on. We see vessels orders placed in Europe, many, in US, again many, but also in Asia and Australia and the Middle East. Also another trend, until 2013 we mainly had small vessels, ferries, small passenger ferry vessels, tags and offshore supply vessels. So the second trend that has been observed since 2013 is that we're moving from smaller vessels to larger vessels, and we now see orders for bulk carriers, big container ships and also gas carriers. This is a list, extensive list, we're not going to go through, you will have it probably in the presentation that you'll receive. We have 76 vessels in operation worldwide at the moment. This is excluding LNG carriers. We don't consider them this because naturally they transport LNG, so they burn also the boil of gas in most of the cases. So LNG carriers and inland waterway vessels have been excluded from this list. So we have 76 vessels in operation, here's an extensive list, and 86 on the order book. In total we have 162 LNG fuel projects, and here we can see the area of operation. Basically on the left hand side you see the vessels that operate, the operational area of the vessels currently, the existing vessels currently in operation, and you see that the majority, 69% is in Norway. This changed recently, 6 months ago it was 88% in Norway. So, and then you see a minority in Europe, very small percentage in US, and almost 6% in Asia, nothing. But when we go to the order book, you see that the largest majority, 58%, close to 6% is in Europe. So vessels in on the order book have been ordered to operate in Europe, in EU waters. Big also share in the market has US, 25%, and you see Norway from 69% has now a market share, or will have a less market share, and then in the order book they only have a market share of 14%. This is a big shift, so shows us that Norway doesn't play anymore, it's not anymore the leader, or will not be the leader. The industry has moved outside Norway, and LNG as a fuel has started becoming more and more popular in Europe and US. It's interesting also to see the LNG uptake by the vessel segment, and basically you see in a green color, you see the vessels in operation, and you see what we also discussed a bit earlier, car and passenger ferries and offshore supply vessels have the largest stake in the market. And the order book, again, car passenger ferries have 12 vessels currently, but what is very interesting to see is that the container ships here and the gas carriers have a big, big share. So we are moving to larger vessels, also oil and chemical tankers, 11. So these are the three segments which have at the moment the largest uptake on the order book. And it's also very interesting to see, think a bit about the reasons behind. And at the moment we have to do with LNG as a fuel, requires some big installations, requires some heavy equipment and big equipment, and requires space. And for example, space in bulk carriers, you don't have that much. In tankers and container ships, you have more. So naturally, these are the vessel segments which are showing and will continue showing the largest uptake in terms of the equipment to be installed. Some few words about the supply. We already heard earlier some insights are regarding supply of LNG and what the future market outlook would be. But some reflections from our side. earlier the speaker from DEPA talked about the chicken and egg. The chicken and egg issue has been dragging for a very long time. Many people were talking about, okay, who will provide the supply of LNG, and the suppliers were talking about, okay, where's the demand? So ship owners didn't dare to invest because also the investment cost is quite heavy. At the moment, we don't see this, and we feel that this debate is finally almost over. We see large projects coming into operation soon. We see suppliers doing the first move. We see bunker vessels which will offer flexibility in terms of supply in the order book and to be delivered soon. Bunker ships will become available already from 2016, 2017 in areas like US and the area of Amsterdam, Rotterdam and Antwerp, where you have very high traffic of vessels, and most of the vessels burning LNG will be operating. So there will be available LNG in large portions, large volumes. At the moment you can find LNG in terminals in Norway, small scale terminals. And also you can ask for bunkering by trucks, and this is taking place already in several places. Import terminals, we saw I think earlier as well from another speaker a map where we can see all the import terminals and export terminals in Europe and in what kind of status they are. Are they in operation or be decided or they are under construction? We believe that import terminals will be able to supply bunker vessels. The same issue will happen here also, hopefully with Revithusa. The sizes of these volumes that are going to be a bit leaked from the import terminals are in the range of 1,000 to 8,000 cubic meters, and this is a really good amount to fuel large vessels like bulk carriers, container ships, ferries, general cargo vessels that are going to be using LNG as a fuel. And of course we are aware that distributors and LNG suppliers also need to have sustainable business, and as soon as the volumes are going to be generated, the supply of the molecules of the LNG of the fuel will need to be in a very competitive pricing. At the moment we see prices high due to also the risk behind this the distribution cost. So suppliers probably giving a bit higher prices in the which is added in the distribution cost due to the risk that is hindered behind this business. We feel that with a distribution cost, so a distribution cost basically is the cost that comes on top of the price of the existing gas, which is in the import terminal. We feel with a price range of around $2 per MBTU is possible when a bunker vessel is fully in operation, operates in one full week, for example, with volumes around 6,000 to 8,000 volumes sold per week. And finally, we believe that bunker ships will be able to operate in a radius, in an area of around 200 to 250 nautical miles. And when we try to map a bit the Mediterranean, you see all these red circles, which shows basically the blue dots show import terminals in Europe, existing ones. And if we assume that we can use these import terminals to take some molecules and give to small-scale industry and give to vessels to burn LNG as a fuel with the usage of bunker vessels, you can see that a big portion of Mediterranean will have supply. So the red circles basically show an area that a bunker vessel can cover and offer supply. Do you think that these are enough possibilities, supply possibilities? In my head, yes, but if somebody is in doubt, my company, DNVGL, developed an LNG intelligence portal, which offers the required insight and a lot of information on LNG and LNG bunkering. And basically, it's called LNGI, LNG Intelligence. You can find more information in this webpage. And I have put some snapshots for you here. So basically, it's a web-based portal which provides all the needed information for you to be on top of the LNG bunkering market and the recent developments, as well as on the bunkering side and also on the fleet side. It has a map which is lively updated. It's the first one that is happening, the first such portal in the world, which is continuously updated with all the recent developments. It has a heat map that shows where are the LNG fueled vessels currently in operation and how much fuel they burn and where do they operate. You can see here some pictures. You see here all these yellow dots are the LNG fueled vessels. And you can see here that the most dense traffic is at the moment in Norway. You have statistics about the fleet, similar statistics that we saw earlier. And also you have information in addition for scrubbers and alternative fuels. Here are some snapshots again. You see here, these dots here indicating projects with different colors in order which classify if the projects are in operation or under discussion or actually under construction. Here you have the heat map we discussed earlier. All these yellow maps, the yellow dots are LNG fueled vessels trading, for example, here in Norway. You can see also some crossing the Atlantic. You have some filters you can play with, and you can filter depending on what you're looking for, if it's a large scale, small scale terminal, what kind of bunkering you're looking for, it's a ship to ship, truck to ship, you want to see only the vessels that are in operation. And when you click on a project, you can see more information about this project and regarding the status and the features that you find in that project, in that terminal. For example, here it's like an LNG bunkering facility in Sarnia. And you can see the country and some information regarding the capacities installed, the storage capacities installed in these places. Speaking of statistics, an interesting, I guess, for at least for us, statistic. We have this debate regarding which one will be, which one will have the largest uptake. It's going to be scrubber or LNG as a fuel. The competition is quite strong. Although we see here at the end the total picture where scrubbers are overtaking a lot LNG vessels, but what is interesting to see, so scrubbers are in blue, LNG fuel vessels are in green, but what is interesting to see is the uptake of retrofit compared to new builds. And you see with light blue are scrubber retrofit projects, where in dark blue it's new builds, whereas for LNG the dark green is new builds and the light green are retrofits. So you see scrubber is the preferred option for retrofit, whereas for new builds it's clearly LNG. So concluding some key takeaways from this presentation. Increase in LNG production, we saw earlier that US and Australia are coming in quite strong. The next 5 years we expect a 40% increase on the LNG production. This, as already has been discussed and said, will keep and is expected to keep prices under pressure and will also most probably bring some level out of the global pricing scheme, because now we have different pricing schemes in Europe, Japan and or Asia and US. The low oil price is delaying the market development. The market development has not happened with the pace that we have been expecting. Of course, the crisis and also the low oil prices have been delaying this high development or the development pace of LNG as a fuel. However, bunker ships and the first cargo vessels in Europe will come and be available in 2016 and 2017. And this, we believe, will motivate followers in order to see that this is an established solution, this is a safe solution, and the supply is there for them to order. From a regulatory point of view, everything is in place. IMO has already published this IGF code, which is the code required for building vessels safely. Of course, you have guidelines also for safe bunkering and et cetera, et cetera. And from a technology point of view, the technology is there, it's proven, is tested. Both big manufacturers, Wärtsilä and MAN, have two-stroke engines. And this, we believe, technology that is currently there, we believe will also motivate followers. So we believe that all following all new builds or new orders that might come soon, because at the moment the order book and the sentiment for ordering due to the high oversupply of vessels in the market is quite low. When this will start pick up again, we believe that all future projects we should consider LNG as a fuel as an option. Of course, it's depending on the cost, on the business case, on the travel, on the operational profile, and where the vessel is going to trade. But we believe that LNG is relevant for all new build projects in the moment, in the future. So the perspective for LNG as a fuel, we believe it still stays positive. Thank you very much for your attention. If you need any more information, please contact me directly, since the presentation was quite short and you might have more interesting questions in the future and you require more material, please feel free to contact me. Thank you very much.
Ευχαριστούμε κύριε Χιοντόπουλο που για πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα παρουσίαση, πολλά νέα στοιχεία τα οποία δεν γνωρίζαμε, ιδίως για τις, τα νέα πλοία τα οποία εμφανίζονται και των πολύ σημαντικές αλλαγές που γίνονται στην αγορά. Θα προχωρήσουμε αμέσως στην παρουσίαση της κυρίας Καραγιάννη και μετά όποιος έχει ερωτήσεις θα τελειώσουμε το session με ερωτήσεις. Κυρία Καραγιάννη. Κυρία Καραγιάννη είναι εμπειρογνώμων σε θέματα διεθνούς δικαίου και δικαίου της θάλασσας, της θαλάσσης. Είναι εμπειρογνώμων στο Υπουργείο Προστασίας του Πολίτη. Κάνει ένα μεταπτυχιακό. Έχει λάβει μέρος σε αρκετά συνέδρια και ασχολείται ιδιαίτερα με τα θέματα της Κασπίας και της Ρωσίας. Δεν ξέρω αν τα είπα όλα. Εντάξει, κυρία Καραγιάννη.
Well, being the last, I'm going to cut my presentation quite short in order not to tire you any longer. My topic is not about energy security, but security of critical energy and maritime infrastructure. It's a very specific topic of growing importance due to the ongoing insecurity and instability in our area, in Europe, in the Mediterranean, and in the Middle East. It has become a matter of growing concern in the Euro-Atlantic area, both within the EU and NATO, as most states rely on resources that are located abroad, often in faraway and unstable regions. They are therefore dependent on a series of external developments, some of which are displaying worrying security trends lately. At the NATO-Riga summit in 2006, allied governments have tasked NATO to consider its potential role in enhancing energy security collectively. The outcome was presented at NATO's Bucharest summit in 2008, where it was agreed that the disruptions of the supply chain, which involve physical attacks against energy infrastructure through acts of terrorism and other forms of violence, are addressed mainly through what is referred as SAPE in Europe and in NATO terminology, critical energy infrastructure protection, meaning policies aiming to reduce vulnerabilities of the critical energy infrastructure in order to minimize the probability and the potential impact of a successful attack. As a result, SAPE does not examine disruptions connected to accidents, natural disasters, embargoes, or political decisions made by supplier states and/or companies. The energy sector involves several kinds of infrastructures, all interdependent between them, for the extraction, production, or generation of energy, infrastructures for land and maritime transport, processing, refining, storage, and distribution. Most countries in Europe and in the US are major net importers of energy, thus coming in the end of the energy supply chain. This means that they are dependent on a whole series of energy infrastructures which comes before them in the supply chain. Many of them are located abroad, outside European territory, mostly in the former Soviet Union and in the Middle East. As a result, a major oil facility in Saudi Arabia, a gas pipeline in the Caucasus, or an LNG terminal in the Mediterranean for Europe and NATO are considered critical energy infrastructure protection. In other words, all these infrastructures are located outside European territory, abroad in far distant countries. These infrastructures are most attractive to terrorists and to foreign terrorist groups, precisely because they come at the beginning of the supply chain, which means that an attack on these infrastructures will have major cascading economic effects, both in the countries themselves and in Europe. Terrorists have all demonstrated already their capability to attack energy infrastructures with many, in many cases. The attack on the Abqaiq oil processing complex in Saudi Arabia in 2006. The bombing attack on the Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan oil pipeline, raising suspicions of a potential cyber attack in 2008. The recent bombing in Amenas gas plant in Algeria in 2013 and in the In Salah gas plant in this year, in March 2016, resulting of which the operating companies of BP and Statoil decided to pull out all their activities and all their personnel out of Algeria. Akim, Al-Qaeda in Islamic Maghreb, took the responsibility for both attacks. It is needless to stress the importance of Algerian LNG production for EU consumers like our country, Greece, Italy and Spain. Moreover, the two major pipelines in the Caucasus, Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan oil pipeline and South Caucasus gas pipeline, are both of them critical energy infrastructures for Europe. Now, with the recent escalation of the Nagorno-Karabakh frozen conflict, it is also a source of major concern. What happens at the sea? One scenario regularly debated in NATO is an attack on oil shipments in the Strait of Hormuz, very critical to global oil supply. Acts of piracy committed at sea raise yet another set of issues. Pirates are very different from terrorists, as they are not politically motivated, but they seek private profit. The number of acts of piracy off the coast of Somalia in the Gulf of Aden has prompted international attention and led both NATO and the EU to get involved directly in the protection of vessels crossing the Gulf of Aden through the Joint Task Force Atalanta. Some experts have also raised fears of a nexus between terrorism and piracy, whereas links between pirates and terrorist groups in South and Southeast Asia urging piracy to raise money for their cause cannot be excluded. At the sea, a first potential target is oil tankers and secondly LNG carriers. Individual vessels as such, as not, they are not considered critical infrastructure, however, an attack on them becomes a serious problem when it causes maritime traffic to be stopped for a long time and causes large losses of oil and major pollution. This is the case. In particular, if an attack occurs at a major maritime choke point. The two main sites are the Straits of Hormuz and Malacca. Other important sites include the Suez Canal, the Bab el-Mandeb, the Bosphorus Straits, Gibraltar and the Panama Canal. As far as LNG is concerned, the protection of LNG facilities is also a cause of major concern. No attack has so far been directed at an LNG facility or an LNG carrier overseas. However, as an even greater number of countries turn to LNG to diversify their energy mix, LNG infrastructures become an increasingly attractive terrorist for attack. Target for terrorists. The number of LNG terminals is also expected to increase significantly in the coming years, especially in the Mediterranean region. Taking into account all the above, the most recent trend is to include in the SAIP, in critical energy infrastructure protection, mobile sea infrastructures like tankers and LNG carriers due to their huge economic importance, particularly those that are operating in the Mediterranean and in the Middle East area. However, this trend has not yet taken the form in the EU of an EU directive or in NATO of a NATO-NAC decision. Finishing, a few words on cybersecurity, which is very important, particularly for maritime sector and maritime infrastructure. Cyber threats are a growing menace, particularly coming from China, with a significant impact on maritime infrastructure. Securing the shape of the maritime sector is increasingly becoming a priority both for the EU and NATO, and for each member state separately for their own reasons. Terrorists have, and private companies also, have displayed the ability of conducting very sophisticated cyber attacks using primary technology. The fragmentation of European maritime policies brings difficulties for the clear definition of responsibilities and roles. More so, there is a growing trend of maritime ports and port infrastructure privatization, such as the ports of Piraeus, Thessaloniki and Stockholm, while others, like the port of Hamburg, are in the process of being already privatized. As a result, security standards here involve not only the states, but also the private sector. As this overview shows, to conclude, both NATO and the EU are at a relatively early stage in defining their potential contribution to an enhanced protection of a critical energy and maritime infrastructure worldwide. They have so far adopted quite distinct approaches, with the EU considering a role in the coordination of national policies and NATO in outreach assistance, as well as under specific circumstances, direct interventions. As these roles are bound to develop in the future, one priority should be to ensure that there is no duplication of efforts. As far as Greece is concerned, our primary attention is in the Mediterranean, and of course in our critical facilities, the ports, LNG, the Vithousa terminal, our refineries in Athens and in Thessaloniki, as well as the DEPA pipeline of domestic internal distribution system. Of course, also in the future, when we will have TAP pipeline crossing Greek territory also, there's going to be a major attention drawn from the part of the Hellenic state to secure the pipeline. Thank you for your attention and for your patience.
Για την διάσταση της ενεργειακής ασφάλειας την οποία έδωσε όσο αφορά τις εγκαταστάσεις τις ναυτιλιακές και τις πετρελαϊκές συμπεριλαμβανομένου και του LNG. Εγώ έχω δύο ερωτήσεις να κάνω, πρώτα για τον κύριο Χιωτόπουλο, που έδειξε μια πολύ ωραία χάρτη της Μεσογείου με τους κύκλους, από πού μπορούν να προμηθευτούν τα πλοία τα οποία δουλεύουν με LNG, κινούνται με LNG. Και δείξατε ότι έχουν μία κτίνα δράση στα πλοία, αν δεν κάνω λάθος, γύρω 200 με 250 μίλια. Θέλω να μας το εξηγήσετε αυτό και πώς συνδυάζεται αυτό με την τροφοδοσία τους.
Ναι, ουσιαστικά οι κύκλοι που δείξαμε ήταν bunker vessels. Ουσιαστικά ήταν σε ένα υποθετικό σενάριο στο οποίο το supply θα γίνεται με bunker vessels. Άμα υπάρχουν bunker vessels κοντά στα import terminals, αυτά τα bunker vessels θα μπορούσαν να θεωρηθούν υποθετικά, αλλά και πρακτικά γίνεται αρκετά εύκολα πιστεύω, να ενεργοποιούνται σε αυτή την ακτίνα των 250 ναυτικών μιλίων και όπως είδαμε με τους κύκλους στο χάρτη, ουσιαστικά καλύπτεται όλη η περιοχή. Οπότε κάποιο πλοίο το οποίο καίει σαν κάψιμο LNG και περνάει από τη Μεσόγειο, θεωρητικά θα μπορούσε να εξυπηρετηθεί και να βρει κάψιμο.
Τα πλοία τα οποία κινούνται με LNG έχουν κάποια περιορισμένη ακτίνα σε σύγκριση με τα άλλα που κινούνται με πετρέλαιο?
Ναι, αυτό είναι το μεγαλύτερο πρόβλημα αυτή τη στιγμή και το οποίο νομίζω συζητήθηκε και στο πρώτο πάνελ, είναι για το volume και ουσιαστικά την ενέργεια που υπάρχει μέσα σε ένα συγκεκριμένο όγκο φυσικού αερίου, ο οποίος είναι αρκετά μεγαλύτερος από το πετρέλαιο. Το οποίο σημαίνει ότι χρειάζεται πολύ μεγαλύτερα fuel tanks για να ουσιαστικά να αποθηκεύσεις LNG, το οποίο θα σε βγάζει για αρκετά ναυτικά μίλια. Ένα παράδειγμα είναι ότι χρειάζεται γύρω στα 3.000 κυβικά μέτρα για να πας από την Ολλανδία στην Αμερική και πίσω, το οποίο καταλαμβάνει αρκετό χώρο πάνω στο πλοίο και λόγω των κάποιων regulations που υπάρχουν για safety regulations από τον IMO και από τα classification societies. Χρειάζεται κάποιο safety space γύρω από το tagging, χρειάζεται κάποιο insulation, χρειάζεται κάποιο χώρο για inspection, οπότε όλο αυτό μαζί παίρνει γύρω στις 2-3 φορές περισσότερο χώρο από τα συμβατικά fuel tanks που έχουμε τώρα. Οπότε χάνει αρκετό χώρο το πλοίο αυτή τη στιγμή.
Και γι' αυτό από ό,τι είδα υπάρχει μεγάλο ποσοστό πλοίων, των νέων πλοίων που είναι passenger vessels, το οποίο σημαίνει ότι βρίσκονται σε πολύ ανάμεσα σε δύο λιμάνια, οπότε είναι εύκολος ο νεφοδιασμός. Θα ήθελα να ζητήσω την κυρία Καραγιάννη να μας πει λίγο το πρακτικό κομμάτι του SAPE, δηλαδή υπάρχει κάποιος, πώς γίνεται ο συντονισμός, υπάρχει κάποια γραμματεία, πού λογοδοτούν, πώς έχει οργανωθεί αυτό για να έχει μια πρακτική εφαρμογή και να, όντως να δώσει μια προστασία στα συμβαλόμενα μέλη.
Πολύ καλή ερώτηση. Δυστυχώς δεν υπάρχει κάποιο κεντρικό όργανο και δεν υπάρχει κάποιο συντονισμός σε κυβερνητικό επίπεδο. Τα θέματα τα χειρίζεται το ΝΑΤΟ, βασικά, καταρχήν, και κατά δεύτερο λόγο η Ευρωπαϊκή Ένωση. Οπότε τα αρμόδια Υπουργεία, σε ό,τι αφορά ΝΑΤΟ, είναι το Υπουργείο Δημόσιας Τάξης και το Υπουργείο Εθνικής Αμήνης, και σε ό,τι αφορά ΕΕ, είναι το Υπουργείο Εξωτερικών. Είναι νέα θέματα και σε επίπεδο Ευρωπαϊκής Ένωσης και ΝΑΤΟ. Το ΝΑΤΟ ξεκίνησε από το 2009 να έχει το πάνελ και την επιτροπή, την αρμόδια για αυτά τα θέματα. Οπωσδήποτε υπάρχει αυξανόμενο ενδιαφέρον λόγω της κατάστασης και της ρευστότητας, ειδικά στη Μέση Ανατολή, που έχει προκαλέσει όλη αυτή την ανησυχία. Αλλά δυστυχώς σε ελληνικό επίπεδο δεν υπάρχει κάποιο συντονιστικό όργανο το οποίο να μας μαζεύει όλους και να υπάρχει μια συντονισμένη δράση.
Δεύτερη ερώτηση είναι στο SAPE. Μπορεί να, κάτω την ομπρέλα του SAPE, να υπαρχθούν και πλοία και εγκαταστάσεις οι οποίες είναι γύρω στην θάλασσα. Πώς λειτουργεί το...
Από την οδηγία της Ευρωπαϊκής Ένωσης του 2006, όλες οι εγκαταστάσεις fixed infrastructure εντάσσονται στο SAPE. Ακριβώς επειδή όμως αυξάνεται ο αριθμός των tankers και αυξάνεται και ο αριθμός των LNG carriers, υπάρχει η τάση, αλλά δεν έχει ακόμα θεσμοθετηθεί, δεν υπάρχει νομοθέτηση σε επίπεδο κανονισμού ΕΕ ή απόφαση του ΝΑΚ στο ΝΑΤΟ, ούτως ώστε να ενταχθούν και όλα τα vessels στο SAPE. Υπάρχει όμως ένα αυξημένο ενδιαφέρον, γι' αυτό και έγινε και η επιχείρηση Αταλάντα στον κόλπο του Άντεν, όπου συμμετείχαν ανά 6 μήνες περιοδικά και ελληνικές φρεγάτες για την προστασία των tankers και dry cargo, όχι μόνο tankers, και LNG carriers, όλα.
Γίνονται τακτικά ασκήσεις και στη Μεσόγειο έχουν γίνει ασκήσεις.
Ναι, και στη Μεσόγειο και στην Ανατολική Μεσόγειο, και γίνονται και ασκήσεις και με τη συμμετοχή όλων των ατοϊκών χωρών, επίσης στη Βαλτική. Αφορά όλες τις χώρες αυτό, όχι μόνο τις μεσογειακές.
Υπάρχουν ερωτήσεις από το ακροατήριο, παρακαλώ.
Πολύ σωστά. Και γι' αυτό στο conclusion μου είπα ότι έχουμε δει ένα τρομερό delay ή ένα slowdown, αν μπορώ να το πω καλύτερα, του development. Από την άποψη ότι 1,5 χρόνο πριν οι τιμές του πετρελαίου, όταν χρειαζόταν να πληρώσεις για HFO γύρω στα $600-700 και το μπορούσες να βρεις LNG πολύ φθηνότερα, τότε το business case ήταν αρκετά attractive. Έβγαζε, αν θυμάμαι καλά, τότε κάναμε κάποιες αναλύσεις και υπήρχε ένα payback time των 6-7 χρόνων, το οποίο στο lifetime ενός πλοίου είναι αρκετά attractive. Με τις τιμές αυτή τη στιγμή, Να είμαστε ειλικρινείς, δεν είναι attractive για κανέναν. Όταν χρειάζεται γύρω στο 30 με 35% το κόστος, το investment cost του πλοίου, additional cost για να βάλεις LNG, γιατί τόσο κοστίζει πάνω κάτω το LNG installation, δεν είναι αρκετά attractive. Έχουμε δει αυτή τη στιγμή seagoing vessels ή τέλος πάντων μεγάλα vessels σε specific projects και ειδικά πλοία, ας πούμε, είχαμε τα πρώτα bulk carriers, τα οποία παραγγέλθηκαν πριν 3-4 μήνες, το οποίο έχει specific trade, είναι στη Βαλτική, είναι 100% exposure σε ECA requirements, οπότε πρέπει να καίει 0-1 και έχει ένα charter agreement γύρω στα 25 χρόνια. Οπότε είναι purposely built vessels και purposely built projects. Αυτό που βλέπουμε είναι ότι πλοία τα οποία χτίζονται τώρα είναι το καινούριο concept, αυτό το LNG ready. Δηλαδή πλοία τα οποία όταν χτίζονται ή όταν γίνονται design έτσι ώστε στο μέλλον να μπορούν εύκολα να μπορούν να κάνουν retrofits LNG. Δηλαδή είτε αφήνεις λίγο χώρο να βάλεις το LNG tank, είτε βάζεις μια μηχανή η οποία μπορεί να γίνει convert σε dual fuel. Υπάρχει ένα σχέδιο στη θέση του, οπότε έχουν προνοηθεί όλα τα που θα μπει τι πάνω στο πλοίο. Αυτά είναι τα LNG ready και είναι ένα intermediate solution από το τίποτα μέχρι το full LNG fueled option.
Θα ήθελα να ευχαριστήσω και τους ομιλητές στο τελευταίο session. Καταληκτικά να πω ότι το σεμινάριο αυτό μας έδωσε πολλές χρήσιμες καινούργιες πληροφορίες για το τι γίνεται στην αγορά, την διεθνή αγορά, το ρόλο των ελληνικών γραφείων και εταιριών ναυτιλιακών πάνω σε αυτά τα θέματα. Το θέμα της κρίσης με την τιμή σαφώς επηρεάζει, ό,τι είδαμε, όλες τις δραστηριότητες και στο πετρέλαιο και στο φυσικό αέριο. Και για άλλους είναι θετικό αυτό, όπως είδαμε στα chartering των tankers. Για άλλους όμως, για την αγορά ευρύτερα, όχι τόσο καλό, διότι η αγορά έχει μπει σε ένα momentum επενδύσεων, το οποίο ξαφνικά με την απότομη μείωση των τιμών μειώθηκε και που να αναπροσαρμοστεί θα περάσει κάποιος χρόνος, χωρίς αυτό να είναι απαγορευτικό, καθότι θα ήθελα να θυμίσω ότι είχαμε 20 χρόνια περίπου από το τέλος του 80 μέχρι το 2010, όλη δεκαετία του 90 και του 2000, που είχαμε πολύ χαμηλές τιμές πετρελαίου. Παρ' όλα αυτά, η πετρελαϊκή βιομηχανία προχώρησε, επενδύσεις έκανε και μετά το 2003-2004 είδαμε μία αύξηση των τιμών, το οποίο επέτρεψε η βιομηχανία να επεκταθεί πολύ πιο γρήγορα. Τώρα ξανά βρισκόμαστε σε κάποιους διαφορετικούς ρυθμούς και ίσως να μην είναι και τόσο κακό ώστε να μπορέσουμε να κάνουμε ένα consolidation. Λοιπόν, θα υπάρξουν κάποια συμπεράσματα, θα υπάρξουν όλα τα όρισε ομιλίες και παρουσιάσεις στο microsite. Ελπίζω με αρχές του Μαΐου να το έχουμε ολοκληρώσει, οπότε και θα σας ειδοποιήσουμε ηλεκτρονικά και θα έχετε όλη ελεύθερη πρόσβαση σε αυτό. Και πάλι θα ήθελα να σας ευχαριστήσω και τον χορηγό μας τη ΔΕΠΑ και το site, το Energy.gr και το Maritime για την πολύ χρήσιμη βοήθεια. Και έχουμε ένα ποτό, θα χαρούμε πολύ να σας δούμε δίπλα στην άλλη αίθουσα. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.